Alrighty. Now it looks like for this other part of the case, oh, there's a couple of dowels here. There's one here, one over here. Let's see here, like this. So there's one dowel here, one dowel here. I didn't see any dowels on the other side, so it looks like they're staying with this centerpiece of the case. And looks to be that that is the only dowel pieces there are, so that is perfect. Yep, the rest are all bolt holes. So we just want to make sure we don't lose those dowels. They seem to be in there really well, so I think I'm just going to leave them. Oh, no, this one's coming out. That one came out, so I'll give that a wash, put it in the parts bucket. It's good, it's in good shape. So let's see if we can get the other one out too then. Might need a pair of pliers to do so. I'm gonna be a bit gentle with this. I don't wanna mar it up, so if it'll come, great. If not, I'm leaving it. And it doesn't wanna come, so I'm leaving it. I don't wanna mar it up. It can stay there. All right. That's a lot of rotating mass. Potentially largely because it's full of grease instead of oil. Okay, these look like they're probably a 10. What we got here? We got a 10 right here. Yep, looks like a 10. Is a 10. Where's my ratchet? Right here. Okay, just gonna break them. Try to break them. Oh, that is tight, and I don't want to take my fingers off that spline. Whoa, is that tight. Whew. That is in there. We use Loctite for sure. Okay. Sorry. Let's grab a hold of that again. Oh, that's tight. Now you might ask, well, why don't I just use the impact? Well, what I got are large air impact guns, and I don't like using impact at all with aluminum. So I would much rather do it with a hand ratchet and at least just break them free, kind of get that feel for them, for how they are, and then switch over to like the drill to spin them out. Just my preference, do what you want, but I don't know, it's just not really my thing. And I definitely don't like using impacts putting stuff together. Yeah, look at that red Loctite. Lots of it too. Especially aluminum, but pretty much anything. It's too easy to get it wrong, strip it out, stuff like that. Now this doesn't really want to come apart as easy as the first section, but they did give you a handy little pry spot right here. So I'm just going to shove a screwdriver in there and give it a little twist. That'll get us started. Now you don't want to wreck any of the surfaces, mating surfaces, because I'm pretty sure there's no gasket on here, so it is like precision machined. So you want to be careful with that. So I definitely don't want to be going in prying with a screwdriver, with the exception that I just see another little pry spot right here. won't accept as big of a screwdriver, but just a little nudge there should work. So I got a smaller flat screwdriver here. I'm just going to put it in this little edge and just kind of nudge it in, give it a little bit of a very slight twist. And let's see where we're at now then. Alternatively, is you can use a soft blow hammer. So a hammer with that's rubber, whatever. Now I got this, it'll turn a wee bit. I can get more grip on it. But yeah, you can use soft blow hammer and just kind of find, you know, a strong lobe like this one's pretty reinforced. Give it a couple of whacks there, which I might end up doing here. I'm always nervous about using my hook because, like I say, it's titanium. It's much harder than this aluminum. And I have marred up aluminum in the past. Without even realizing it until it's too late. So I get a little nervous, especially on machine surfaces. On the outside, whatnot, not as big of a deal. But on the machine surfaces, I get nervous about it. Yeah, it should be popping off here, but it is on there tight still. What is that surface there? There we go. Okay. So on the center section of the carrier, housing, whatever you want to call it, we got your ring gear. We'll have to push that out. Get that all out, because there's a bearing in there we obviously want to replace. And then here is your outer section. So we got bearing and seal here. We got the pinion, we got a pull. Look at that wee little bit of grease that's in there, a little bit of oil that's actually been in this diff, and it is chocolate milk. It is just gross. So, I just moved the shim, so that will be a shim. It was right here on this bearing here, so that would ride on this section right here of the ring gear, and that will be one of potentially multiple shims, which looks like there is, to get your proper tooth pattern. So this is the part that gets complicated. So here's a second shim. So this one was on the inside of the ring, which really doesn't matter because all they're doing is providing exact spacing, and they're two different sizes. One is much heavier than the other. Okay, this one is so thin that you could easily bend it, flex it, and destroy it. You don't want to do that. These shims are not cheap. This one, if I can get it off again, get my finger underneath there. So this one's much heavier. You know, it'd be considerably harder to bend and flex and stuff. But again, you don't want to. They are precision for, they're put in for this differential with these bearings and everything else. So basically, once we put the new bearings in and everything else, we have to do a tooth pattern check on it to see how the pinion is mating with the ring gear, and we may have to change those shims. I am hoping that I don't. I'm really hoping that I don't have to, and that this won't be an issue for me, because, like I say, it can be expensive getting the right shims. So hopefully not. And it's a bit of a guessing game as to what shims you need. So, you know, you buy one, you either buy a full kit and use one maybe, or you buy one and find out you need different ones. Basically, yeah, choose your shims based off of a different, how the tooth pattern looks. Kind of guess what you need, try it, see how the tooth pattern is, and go from there. Basically rinse and repeat until you get it right. So that is that. Can actually see where that pry spot was right here. It's a bit of a cutout right here, and it's just an empty cavity, allowed mud to get in there, and it's not technically on the mating surface, but it is. And same for this one up here. That was another little pry spot. So what you want to do is you go in, like on this one here, you put your screwdriver in to and then just give it a twist to wedge it apart, but you don't put your screwdriver in past the mating surface, just into this cavity. That way you can't damage the mating surface and you can still get your pry position done, right? Whatever you're doing. There's another really tiny one right here as well to go with the big one, but that is that. Now I need to pop out this seal, which was obviously failing as well, and I need to get this drain plug out because that's not going to do me any good. Bearing's not moving very freely. Sounds a little gritty, not horrible. There's no real play in it. Sounds a little gritty and it's not moving horribly freely, but listen to that. That is horrible, and that's the one that I figured was going to give me issues. That sounds pretty bad. So, and there's a little, should be a little needle bearing in here as well that the pinion goes into. Kind of assuming, being that there's no way to punch it out, that it basically just falls out, hopefully. Alright, so I'm going to punch out this seal, and this bearing. We'll move the center half off to the side for now. We'll just get to work on the outer case. And this one, I might actually even be able to use a punch. An actual, nope. Nope, the smallest one won't fit. Alright. Looks like we do the same thing as the other seal, is we try to just dig it out. So, sometimes they'll just dig out nice and easy. Give that a try first. Oh, look at that. I just about lost two shims. Look at that. Let's put those all back on there where they belong. All right. As I'm saying, hey, you need to keep an eye on these. Oh, look at that. That one came out super easy, but look at how crudded up that was. Yeah. That one was leaking in here up against the axle. It's got crap inside it, everything else. Well, that's garbage, but that came out super easy. Now we can get our punch in here and punch out that bearing. Let's see what one we'll use. Probably not that one. Let's try this. That one's a little better. Let's try this. No, that one's just not going to fit. All right, the other one it is. This guy right here. Now we're punching out against the inner race, which isn't the best, because if that bearing were in bad shape, it could just end up pulling apart, and then the inner race will still be in there, and you'd have, well, at that point, I think you'd be down to using a bunch of heat and cold and whatever else to try to get that out of there. But we should be okay. Let's get this handle in my hand. Something like that should work. I'm all. That one came out nice and easy. All right, so that bearing is out and it is crusty. Yeah. Oh yeah, that's not moving cleanly. Yeah, not too bad. Might have gotten just a little crap in there while I was doing it there. But yeah, it's not too bad. All right. There was some crud in behind that though. Interesting. Okay, surfaces all look good. That looks really clean. Seal surface looks good. Yeah, seal surface looks good. Everything looks good there. All right, let's tackle this pinion. So there's a nut in there we got to pull first. Looks like it's a locking style nut. No idea what size it is. Let's take a wild guess. It's definitely not a 12. Let's try a 14. No, I'm in trouble. That is a 14, but how do I hold the how do I hold the pinion from spinning? How do I do that? Don't tell me I gotta put the case back together. How do I do that? I don't know. Looks like we're hitting the repair manual, and I could use a coffee. So let's give that a go. I'm gonna go grab a coffee. While I was mulling over how to deal with that pinion, I noticed this drain plug actually has a bit of a shoulder on it. So I was able to put a pair of vice grips on there and loosen that off. Just a barely enough of a shoulder. You got to be careful that you don't clamp onto the case, but barely just enough of a shoulder to get a pair of vice grips on that, and that allowed me to get that drain plug off. So now I'm gonna go and we'll keep this little aluminum crush washer, but I'm gonna take this in and try to find a hex bolt, because I think a hex bolt's better in places where you're playing with mud, because those pack in too easy. And get me a hex bolt that'll fit this for a new drain plug. So there's a win. I still don't know how to deal with this yet. I gotta go hit the manual and see. So I'll be back. Okay, I came up with a solution for that carrier bearing, or nut, I guess, carrier nut on the end of the pinion here. So if you're doing this job, and hopefully you see this before you start this job, take that nut off first thing. First thing you do, don't even, you know, well, take the tires off, I guess, because you can use the brakes to hold the the differential from spinning. Basically is after you get the tires off, remove the propeller shaft and then remove this nut. It'll save you a ton of hassle. And in fact, once everything's on the quad, that's when I'm actually going to torque that nut back into spec, when I put it back together. But I got lucky. I didn't have to put the entire differential back together, and I found a way around needing their special tool to do this on a bench. Basically, I had to reseat the bearing that I pulled out of the pinion side of the case and put the pinion and the ring part of the case back together. Then that spline, I basically sandwiched it in my vise between two pieces of cedar. Okay. Now I tried to pull that off with just a ratchet and using a pry bar to hold this from spinning, because obviously as it spins, it's spinning the spline, right? Like you can see, like I'll spin it in the vise and you'll see this turn, right? The pinion turn. Okay. So what was happening was, as I tried to remove the nut, well, this just wanted to spin around the vise. So then I used a pry bar against, wedged in here, and then against the carrier, right? Not the actual case, but this steel carrier, because it's stronger. And tried to use the ratchet and socket again. Unfortunately, what that did then was this gear would still turn, right? That spline down there would still turn, and all it was doing was pushing the cedar out this side and pushing it out that side. So the case was staying in place, but it was just going to shoot those out. So luckily I fired up the old air impact there, and just the impact action was enough to be able to break that free without it shooting that cedar out. And I actually didn't even have to use anything to hold the case from spinning. I did wrap my hook around the end of the impact as a brace to hold it from wanting to spin, but I don't think that was necessary. So anyways, that's back out. Now I can continue on with resplitting these cases, punch this bearing back out, and carry on with the actual teardown. All right, so I'm going to get this all back onto the bench here and clean up some of my tool mess, and then we'll carry on with the teardown. Okay, so here is the nut for that, spindle input, carrier, whatever, I forget the actual name for it. So I'm just going to rub that off here. Get all the nasty grease off it. Wouldn't have even known that was a stainless or at least very silvery nut. It is a lock, like a locking style nut, not an eye lock, it doesn't look like. It looks like it's got those, and then there was a washer as well. It's just got those kind of messed up threads on the outside that creates like a locking action. Okay, and then you got the carrier right there. And then that's what's inside. So we'll pull the rest of that out. So this is your four-wheel drive actuator clutch, which doesn't seem to want to come out. Might be hanging up on that seal. I might have to get that seal out first. Big screwdriver. See if we can get this seal out of here. There we go. Seal's out. Now will that come out? Damn, that got my finger in there and did not want to back out. That's it. Dropping all the grit and grime on my floor. Luckily I'll be cleaning it anyways. Okay. All right, now we're at the point of two nuts. Oh, look at that chocolate milk in there. That is beauty. So you have the nut that's on the spindle or on your pinion, right? And then you have this carrier nut that holds the entire pinion assembly in place. And there's a special tool that goes into this little gap and it pulls this out, this outer nut. And then you can pull the whole pinion out. Now, it was, yeah, like $300 Canadian was the cheapest I could find it, plus some shipping. If you wanted the genuine Kawasaki one, if you wanted the aftermarket one, the cheapest I found it was $130, and it was going to take me like a good month to get, even if I paid the higher $150 price for it, it just wasn't cheap. And so I found on a forum, on the Mud in My Blood forum, that there's a plumbing tool that supposedly works. So I went and bought those and we'll see if that works. Let's go check that out. So these are called shower drain nut pliers, tools, was that sockets? Something like that. They're in the plumbing section. The Mud in My Blood forum person said you need this one, which is 1 7/16", as well as 1 11/32". So the smaller side is 1 11/32". I'm pretty sure that's the small, too small. Yeah. So the 1 7/16" one will apparently work. And holy crap, it actually fits in there. It fits. I paid $35 for this whole kit. So there is five sockets, which technically they're double ended, so 10 sockets. A bar to use with them, because that's just what you do. You put the bar through the hole and wrench on it. And a carrier, and I paid like $35, and I actually didn't even have to pay the full $35. I could have paid less. For a cheaper brand, but I wanted something that looked better built, more precision built, as I had no idea this was going to work in the first place. So I decided, well, let's go with the better thing, best option I can go with to give me the best chance of it working. And it's in there. It is literally, like, it is in there. So let's see if we can break this thing free. No idea. Let's give her a go. Oh, not with just this little bar yanked. That is in there tight. Let's give her a try with a big screwdriver. This one might do her. Oh yeah, that fits nicely. Alright, and let's just position so I'm going down. I don't know how I'm going to hold this. I might actually have to revise it to get that to hold. Let's turn this upside down. Maybe I'll have a better hold that way. Alright, let's see. Might be something where you might just need to use the impact yet again, but I don't know if I got a socket that'll fit the other end of this tool. Oh, that is tight. That is very tight. I kind of feel like I'm going to bend the screwdriver doing this, if I haven't. A little bit, not much. That is in there really tight. All right, let's see if we can figure out another way. You know what, it might be easier if I separate these cases again. Then I got a flat surface to set this on. So let's re-separate these cases and get this out. Okay, so now I can get this laying nice and flat. on the workbench. See if we can get this to work. The other side is it doesn't fit in there really far, so I'm a little nervous about it trying to jump out or something and causing me more headaches as well that way. I'm pretty sure it's not reverse thread. Pretty sure. Oh, that does not want to move. I don't think it's reverse thread. That would be something if it is. See if I got a socket that'll fit this other side. Wonder if a pipe wrench will give me enough leverage here. Bit longer handle. Problem is, it's holding that. Oh, that is in there. Yeah, that's what I was afraid of. That kind of popped out a wee bit. That is super in there. Might have to put a bit of wood in the vise here again and clamp this in. Maybe pull on it that way. Oh, holy crud, that's in there. I better make sure that's not a reverse thread. If the holder seems to be too difficult to break free, apply heat to soften the locking agent. Alrighty, I guess we were gonna apply some heat. That's gonna create a lot of smoke in here. Let's see if we can wipe this down a bit better then. Oh, this one will do. I don't need the other one. The other one's better, but this one will... I think this will apply enough heat. It's not like we're trying to soften the aluminum or anything. We're just trying to soften the locking agent. So let's actually put it right down in there. Oh. That didn't work. Let's... Tried to light it with my heater I got going. There we go. So the manual didn't say anything about it being reverse thread. Won't apply too much heat to this aluminum. All right, let's give her a go. Let's see if that did it. Move my beer out of the way. Oh, that smells delicious. Fucking, ugh, burning oil, burning grease. All right. Not yet. Whew. Add some more heat. that did it. Tool worked and then tried to kill me. Oh, did it not work? Maybe it just slipped. Damn it. I got my hopes up. No, it worked. Just not enough to do by hand yet. So there you go, $300 for a used Kawasaki one, 150, 130 Canadian for an aftermarket, $35 for an entire kit. You could probably buy just this one for under 10. And there's that nut. Bit of heat to release the locking agent, like they said right in the manual, and it worked. Wouldn't touch it, it's probably pretty hot still, but it worked. All right, so then that's what we're looking at right there, is now that is out, that basically holds the entire pinion in. We should be able to just pull that pinion out, I believe, anyways. So is that hot? No, that part's okay. There's our pinion. Okay. There be the pinion. And there be a little needle bearing down in there still, right? We're replacing that as well. It's part of the kit. It's held in by a clip. You need a set of clip pliers for that. And I believe that one should just pop out because there's no way to press it out at all. So I'm gonna pull that out of there. Hold on a sec here, I'm just trying to fix my legs again on my stand. So I'm gonna pull that that needle bearing out. Actually, I'm gonna let that cool down a bit first. I'm gonna clean the rest of these parts and then we'll pull that bearing out. Okay, we're basically back at the point of where we were prior to me realizing I needed to put it back together in order to get this carrier nut off. That is done. All right. So, carrier nut. That end washer here. So here's the nut. Here's the washer. That holds this carrier in place. Okay. This just sits on there. It kind of slides on the spline here and it interfaces with this carrier or coupler, I think is what it actually is. Yeah, coupler, duh. Right, so that basically, so the actuator, it has a block that rides in here and that slides this coupler, part of the coupler, on the spline, if I can get it on there, back and forth, which interfaces with this part of the coupler to engage your four-wheel drive, right? Engages your front end, also provides some slop in there, but engages your front end. Okay, so we got those off. I'm going to clean those up here real quick, just give them a quick wipe down. Try to make sure everything's out of there. All right, that looks pretty nice and clean. Right there. All right, we'll put that in our bucket of parts. Clean this part. Now, this, you care about the inside, because that is actually inside the diff and past the seal. So what we do care about is this race area here, which is, it's rough. Unfortunately, I don't have the ability to get another one, so I don't know if there's anything I can do about that right now. I might have to look and see how much one of these are. Get that replaced. Because that's where the seal rides, and clearly crap has gotten in there and chewed that up. Which means that seal is not likely to last. So, that is pretty rough. I'm going to have to take a look and see if I can find myself one of these. If not, it's going back in, but it's not the best option. All right. So then after that, we pulled this nut. That tool worked, the tool for the plumbing worked perfect. They do put Loctite on here. And they do recommend in the repair manual that if it seems to be too hard to come off, to loosen, to apply some heat to soften that locking agent, Loctite. And that will break it free. And that is exactly what I did. I just used a small propane torch, applied heat to the case all the way around the where this nut sits, until I started seeing some bubbling coming up out of the threads. Once I saw that, it came off rather easy. So you could use an impact or whatever if you got a proper tool, but using that plumbing tool for a lot less money, it worked great. So that's awesome. That is clean. All right, so that allowed us to pull out the pinion. Pinion's right here. It's got a nut on it still that's retaining this bearing. And then it has a needle bearing inside the carrier that rides on this part of the pinion. So I'll have to put this in the vise with some wood, obviously. You don't want to scar either this surface, because that's riding on the bearings, or the gears, or the splines here if you decide to go on that side, which I might just for the loosening, because that'll actually bite the wood really well. Where this is obviously cone shaped, so it might just slide on out. We'll get this loose, and then we can press this bearing off and press the new one back on. So that is that. With this came a shim. Sorry, it's the correct name for that. So this shim rode, oops, not on this side, on this side of the bearing. It basically rides right there on the bearing. Inside the case, obviously, and what that does is it kind of just pulls that pinion out just a wee bit to ensure your tooth mesh with your ring gear is correctly spaced. So this is another shim that we may need to change out depending on how the new bearing fits. Obviously, if the new bearing isn't to the exact same measurements as the existing bearing, shims need to be replaced or changed out, not replaced, but changed to make sure that your tooth mesh is correct. So that is in a shim for the pinion. Okay, pinion, we'll deal with that later. We're just gonna set that right there. Inside the case is a needle bearing all the way down there. It's right down in the bottom there, if it's visible. Maybe if I go this way, there might be enough light. But yeah, there's a needle bearing down there that had this external clip on it, which you use a set of snap ring pliers to pull that. Okay. Now, being that that was held in with a snap ring plier, I kind of assumed that that would just fall out, but it doesn't. It is pressed in there. So I got a couple of options. I'm going to actually try to, I think, add a little heat to the case, and maybe I can get that bearing to come out, but I doubt it. And I'm worried about adding too much heat to the case. Could always bake it and try that. But basically, I'm going to need a blind bearing puller on a slide hammer to pull that bearing and get that out. Unfortunately, I don't own such a tool, so I'm going to have to, that's going to have to wait. I'm going to basically just clean this case off with that bearing in there. And that is that for this case piece. I'm going to pull the fill nut as well. But that's about it. So that is the two outer case parts. All seals, bearings, whatnot are removed from them. So we'll set that off to the side. I think we're going to deal with this in a little bit, just not right now. And so we're going to look into this side.